Kawasaki has announced plans to enter the light aircraft piston engine market with a couple of new engine designs, along with what I'd call a very ambitious development roadmap. Before I share some engine details and my thoughts on this move from Kawasaki, let's take a peek into the past to build important context. If you don't care about the historical context and want to dive straight into Kawasaki's plans, just skip to the next chapter on the timeline. Kawasaki is best known today for motorcycles, jet skis, and other recreational vehicles. But the Japanese company actually has deep roots in aviation, going back all the way to 1918. In the 1930s, Kawasaki built the French Salmson II biplane and its engines under license. They later moved on to designing and building their own aircraft up to the end of World War II. Notable examples include the Ki-48 light bomber and Ki-61 fighter, of which over 3,000 were produced. When it comes to aero engines, Kawasaki license-built the Daimler-Benz DB601 V12, the engine that powered the German Bf 109 and 110. Kawasaki's version was called the HA-40 and powered the Ki-61 Hein. After World War II, Japan's aviation industry was essentially dismantled. It wasn't until 1952, when the ban on aircraft development was lifted, that Kawasaki re-entered aviation. Their first post-ban aircraft design was the Lycoming GO-435-powered KAL-1. Only two were built. In the years that followed, Kawasaki license-produced well-known aircraft like the T-33 Shooting Star and the P-2 Neptune. In collaboration with Mitsubishi, Fuji and Shinmaiwa, they co-developed the YS-11 twin turboprop airliner, first built in the early 1960s. Among their most significant achievements are the Kawasaki P-1 maritime patrol aircraft, the T-4 jet trainer, and the C-2 military transport. Interestingly, in the late 1970s and early 1980s, Kawasaki produced the 440 two-cylinder, two-stroke engine, which became popular for use on ultralight aircraft. But it was originally designed for snowmobiles, not aviation. Since World War II, Kawasaki has license-built engines, manufactured engine components, and partnered with major aviation companies like Rolls-Royce, General Electric, and Pratt & Whitney. But until now, they haven't developed their own indigenous piston aero engines from the ground up. That's why it came as a bit of a surprise when Kawasaki announced their light aircraft piston engine development program, marking the first time since World War II that they're developing piston aircraft engines. It raises the question, why would a company not already in general aviation enter a market that in 2023 saw just 4,000 new general aviation aircraft sold worldwide, of which less than half were piston powered? And that was actually the best sales year in about a decade. To put it in perspective, in 2023, global motorcycle sales topped 57 million units. So Kawasaki must be seeing a clear opportunity in the light aircraft market. That leads to another question. What challenges will Kawasaki face entering the general aviation market? And how hard could it be for a company with so much experience building aircraft and non-aviation piston engines to design and build a new piston aircraft engine? At first glance, it might not seem too difficult. But the real challenge lies in making reliable engines and gaining a foothold in one of the most conservative and cautious markets out there. I mean, general aviation still largely relies on engine designs dating back to the 1940s and 50s. That same conservatism has caused many new engine manufacturers to fail in the aero engine market. So the big question is, will Kawasaki be one of the few companies to break through and succeed? Kawasaki aims to achieve type certification for their petrol or gasoline engines by 2030, about 5 years from now. It's certainly achievable, but there's not much time to waste. We don't know exactly what stage they're at right now, but indications suggest they're still in the design and development phase. It's possible they already have a running prototype of the four-cylinder engine, but the inline six, however, is very likely still on the drawing board. The four-cylinder engine is based on Kawasaki's H2 supercharged motorcycle engine, which is currently being ground tested as part of the hybrid electric system on the Volt Aero Casio 330 aircraft. In that setup, the Kawasaki engine provides the combustion power in a hybrid system alongside Safran's electric motor. How closely the aviation version of Kawasaki's engine will resemble the H2 motorbike engine remains to be seen. After that, Kawasaki's next major goal is to certify hydrogen combustion aircraft engines. Hydrogen combustion engines themselves aren't particularly complicated. The real challenge lies in storing the hydrogen fuel, for which there is no simple solution. Hydrogen can be stored either as a gas or a liquid. In its gaseous form, the issue is that hydrogen is not very dense, meaning you'd need massive tanks to provide a reasonable range with a combustion engine. To make storage more practical, the gas can be compressed and would then require smaller tanks. However, compression generates heat, which is already half of what's needed for combustion, and thus makes it more dangerous to store compressed hydrogen. It would also require very thick tank walls, which adds weight. Furthermore, compressing the gas consumes energy, up to about 15% of the fuel's energy content, thus reducing the overall efficiency. Alternatively, hydrogen can be stored in liquid form, which is even more dense. However, to keep it in liquid form, the fuel must be cooled to below minus 253 degrees Celsius, almost absolute zero. Keeping hydrogen below minus 253 degrees Celsius could consume up to 45% of the fuel's own energy content. Moreover, hydrogen in liquid form tends to slowly boil off, as it's nearly impossible to prevent some heat from entering the tank, meaning some fuel returns to gaseous form. This causes pressure to build up, which needs to be vented, resulting in fuel loss. These issues make long-term storage a significant challenge, both in aircraft and at airports. That said, Kawasaki is one of the leading companies in the hydrogen space and has been involved in hydrogen research for decades. Today, Kawasaki is also becoming an increasingly important player in global liquid hydrogen storage and transportation. With Kawasaki Suiza Frontier, the world's first liquefied hydrogen transport ship, as a prime example. Putting Kawasaki's hydrogen ambitions aside for now, the company plans to enter the market with gasoline piston engines. These engines are expected to come in three configurations: naturally aspirated, turbocharged, and hybrid. The engines will be available in four different displacement and cylinder variants. Although not explicitly stated, the 12-cylinder engine appears to be a narrow-angle V configuration based on the pictures. So how do these indicative specifications stack up against engines already in the market? The naturally aspirated 1-liter inline 4 would compete with engines like the Rotax 914 and UL Power UL350. Dry weight seems on par with the competition. The turbocharged version of the inline 4 pushes beyond what Rotax currently offers, competing with engines such as the UL Power UL520, Continental TS-IO360, as well as the increasingly market-ready DeltaHawk V4 two-stroke diesel. Here, in dry weight, the Kawasaki seems to best most of the competition. The 2.1-liter inline-6 engines producing 375 horsepower would compete with the Continental IO550 and the Lycoming IO540 and IO720. The 2.1-liter variants seem in a different power-to-weight ratio class to its competition, even when adding the weight of the coolant and additional components. Then there's the 680 horsepower inline 6 and the V12 engines, which would surpass anything currently established in the piston aero engine market. These would compete with the turboprop engines like the General Electric Catalyst, producing 1300 horsepower, and would outpower smaller turboprops like the Pratt & Whitney PT6. The V12 would also offer better fuel efficiency and a much lower initial cost than the turboprops. The V12 may seem like a bit of a Kawasaki pipe dream, but they want to make a 1,300 horsepower aero V12. That's a modern Rolls-Royce Merlin. So, forgive me if I get a bit carried away. One potential concern is the form factor. As inline engines, these are inherently longer than the competing boxer designs. However, given their relatively small displacement, this likely won't pose too much of a challenge to fit them into many existing aircraft engine bays, assuming retrofits are even Kawasaki's intent. Naturally, being liquid-cooled, they would require some cowling modifications to accommodate additional radiators. Kawasaki is also taking a very modern approach, at least in aviation, with these engines going for fuel injection, FADEC, electronic throttle control, and of course it runs on unleaded gasoline. The inline 6 features an integrated reduction gearbox, which makes sense given its maximum speed of 8,500 rpm is far too fast to spin a propeller. Curiously, the inline 4 lists the gearbox as optional, which doesn't really make sense. At 8,500 rpm, it would absolutely need a reduction gearbox if it's intended to drive a propeller directly. This might actually hint at one of Kawasaki's intended applications for the 4-cylinder engine in a role that doesn't involve directly spinning a propeller. Perhaps as a range extender in a hybrid electric configuration. The big question is whether these engines are truly clean sheet designs or if they're heavily based on Kawasaki's existing recreational engines, especially the H2 engine. As for the inline 6, I don't believe Kawasaki has produced an inline 6 engine since the Z1300 back in the 1980s, so that one likely had to be designed from scratch. In the end, it doesn't really matter as long as these engines are built to withstand the workload demands of aviation engines. Most car and motorcycle engines simply aren't designed to run at 75% power under continuous load for hours on end for most of its life and then still last over 2,000 hours with only routine maintenance, which is more or less the aviation benchmark. We know that higher revving engines can be very reliable in aviation, with Rotax's 9 series engines being a prime example, spinning up to 5,800 rpm. Of course, Kawasaki's 8,500 max rpm is quite a bit higher. The same goes for the reduction drive, which Rotax has proven can be virtually problem-free when maintenance requirements are met. So hopefully Kawasaki designed equally robust gearboxes. Another common concern among today's pilots is liquid cooling. But again, Rotax has proven that liquid cooling can be highly reliable in aviation applications. Ultimately, reliability will probably be the biggest concern with these engines. But with the level of long-term investment Kawasaki is putting into this program, can we reasonably assume that they're prioritizing reliability? I really hope so. So, what do these engines need to succeed? First and foremost, they'll need significant market adoption. Without it, they risk fading into obscurity like so many others before them. For the gasoline engines to gain that traction, they'll need to offer either better fuel efficiency while matching the current levels of reliability, or be significantly cheaper while maintaining the same reliability. Neither will be easy to achieve. But perhaps that's not Kawasaki's ultimate goal. The gasoline engines might just be a stepping stone toward their bigger vision, hydrogen and hybrid propulsion. If they can deliver a working hydrogen or hybrid engine with reasonable range, the current worldwide push for clean energy could catapult them to market leadership, regardless of cost or even reliability. That's my main concern. And yes, maybe that's a pessimistic view. That said, I truly hope they succeed. We've barely scratched the surface, but I'm sure we'll revisit the topic in the coming years. I'd love to know your thoughts on Kawasaki entering the piston aero engine market, so leave a comment below. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.